The thought that life could be better is woven indelibly into our hearts and our brains.
Well, hello and welcome to another edition of our personal empowerment podcast, Finding Yourself in Paradise. I'm Michael Benner.
And I'm Steve Snyder. And our topic today is three ways to love yourself. Now, of course, it could have been four or five or 50, but we picked three really wonderful ones. So, you know, we're all told loving yourself is a wonderful idea, but somehow they forgot the instruction manual. So here's a couple of easy ways. Actually, three easy ways to love yourself.
And I think we also have to, probably best at the top of the show, take a look at our resistance to doing that. As if, what do you think it is, Steve, that we're afraid that people will think we're all full of ourselves and all pompous and arrogant and think we're superior somehow if we're good to ourselves?
I think you could have stopped with, do you think we're afraid? Because I think that, you know, of lots and lots of different things. But the only reason people, I think, don't want to love themselves more is because fear gets in the way. Love and fear are kind of like opposite sides of the same coin in a way. And,
but,
you know.
But what would there be? Let's think this out. What would be the fear of loving yourself more? A fear that...
Well, many things. A fear, first, you said it, a fear of arrogance, a fear of feeling like, you know, I'm big and you're little, self-importance, and people will think that, you know, I'm egotistical and won't like me.
Nobody will like
me. Nobody will like me. There's also loving yourself like, well, but I don't deserve to be loved by myself more. You know, I mean, I'm already loving myself the right amount because I'm only this worthy. And, you know, if I loved myself more, it would be a lie. It wouldn't be true. You know, I'd be pretending that I actually do love myself more than I really do, and I don't want to lie to myself.
Deservability.
There you go.
Is there such a word?
There is now. And
by whose standards, anyway?
Yeah.
I mean, deserving against what set of grades or what bar? How do we do that? Where does that come from?
That's a real good question. Usually parenting, I would think. Society has something to do with all that. But bottom line is putting ourself above others is something we're almost sort of taught not to do, like put yourself last rather than first. And so, like, why not love myself? Well, because it's more important that I love my kids, or it's more important I love my wife, it's more important I love my husband, it's more important I love my, it's more important I love other things than me.
So it's a classic false dichotomy, because the best way to have more love for other people, and I think this is the point we're making here today, is to love yourself more.
The only way, because as I've often said and love to say, all love flows through your own love for you.
All right, so we're going to establish this concept that you have to love yourself to empower yourself to love other people. It has to come in that order. You can't really put yourself last. And then we'll show you how to do that. We'll talk about, as Steve indicated earlier, a couple of different arenas. Did you mention all three? It's the self.
Haven't mentioned any of them yet. The first one is be nice.
Run them down.
The first one's about being nice to yourself. You know, in a way, it's always about loving yourself more. It's really about being nice. It's about being nice to yourself. It's about being nice to another person that you know and care about, you know, and it's being nice to strangers and to society in general. It's random acts of kindness kind of thing. The way to love yourself more is to let that self be acknowledged for good things, for doing things that well, and for being nice, you know, and be nice to yourself. The way you love yourself more is to be nice to yourself and acknowledge yourself for being nice. And then step two is to be nice to somebody else. And then step three is to do something nice for people you don't know. I mean, it's always, in this case, the three ways to love yourself is to be nice to yourself, to somebody you know, and to anybody else or everybody else.
Yeah. I like substituting sometimes for the word love, which is so big and has so many meanings and implications, the phrase, what you care about.
There you go.
Okay, so
where your passion lies.
Yeah, maybe we could begin with, in order to love the planet and the circumstances around me and to have more love for my immediate relationships at home and at work, it's all got to begin with loving myself.
Yes, it
does. What does that mean? Maybe it's just caring about caring, looking at what do I care about and why do I care?
Yeah.
Not what do I think so much, because if I turn my thinking to me and try to understand myself mentally, it's going to be mostly negative.
And the positive and the negative will fight each other, and you won't know which one is the right voice.
Yeah, argue. And that's what feelings are for.
Yeah.
Is to reveal the subjective, the essence of subjectivity. And I'm not saying that's where the self is bound up, but that's certainly a portal to a quality of self based on what do you care about, and then why do you care about that thing, and are you going to respect a part of you that cares beyond thoughts?
Yes, and if you want to love yourself more, then what you will do to do something nice for yourself is to spend more of you on things that you care about. What would be nicer to do than the things that your higher self is attracted to, is drawn toward, is feeling like it was born to be, born to do, born to express? You know, you have gifts, talents, and abilities. You do. Everyone does. And discovering those and developing those, that's one of the nicest things you can do for yourself. So tune in and find out what is it that's inside of you that's unexpressed or is expressed to the extent that you'd like to express it more, and do something really nice by finding what yourself wants to express and give yourself the opportunity to express it.
In the time management segments that I've taught over the years in different situations, it's unfortunate to have to admit this, but most people need to be taught to schedule themselves into their day runner.
Right, and then they're the first ones that they cross off is unimportant anyway, so what's the point?
We're not supposed to live our lives on the scraps of time that are left.
Yeah.
After we've given our lives away or sold them to other people. Now, much of our lives we do have to sell. We need an income stream, of course. But nevertheless, okay, maybe we do have to actually schedule it, but at least to assert ourselves, to have enough self-love and enough confidence and awareness of which self we're talking about here. This is not the, again, the negative self. This is not the worst nature. This is the best nature that we're scheduling time for. I mean, who else would you love? Not your weaknesses, you know, but the best parts of you, and then actually allow the best parts of you to handle the uplifting of the weaknesses, you know. It's largely a process of education, I think. To love yourself is to learn about yourself.
That's the truth, because once you shine a light on the things that you don't know about, then the fear disappears and the love can appear, because fear is just of the unknown.
That's
so,
it. There's confusion and ignorance, unawareness.
So once you shine a light, once you look inside and you pay attention to yourself by going to paradise, what you find is the way you love yourself more, the way you be nice to yourself, really, is to recognize that thing we've talked about so often, that you're not the thoughts, you're the thinker of the thoughts. So if you learn to enjoy all the thoughts, you know, like you have a negative thought and you go, oh, boy, that was nice. I got that out of my system. You have a positive thought. You go, wow, that was really cool. Let me put some more energy into that one. If you like your negative thoughts and you like your positive thoughts, that's one of the nicest things you can do for yourself, because then every thought you have makes endorphins flow inside of you, makes positive, happy chemicals flow instead of the chemicals that you get when you're anxious or nervous, the suppressive chemicals that make you feel, you know, shut down. So learn to love not the thoughts that you have, because you'll have good ones and you'll have bad ones, but learn to love the fact that you're the thinker of the thought, and that when you have a bad one, you can go, oh, good, that's not me, that's just a thought, I can let that one go. And literally, you release a thought, you release anything by letting go, by going, by creating your brain, thinking it feels safe. If the brain feels safe and then at the same time is holding that thought loses all its power. If you hold on to the thought and you go, ah, and your brain goes, oh, wow, this is safe, and I'm holding on to that thought can't be dangerous to me anymore. And all of a sudden, it neutralizes all the power of that thought. So release a thought, and then when you have a positive thought, don't just let it slip. I might go, wow, that was a good one, and reinforce the positive thoughts. If you release the negative thoughts and reinforce the positive thoughts, that's one of the nicest things you can do for yourself and one of the best ways to love yourself more and more.
And built in is that elevated perspective, that higher point of view, that detachment or non-attachment that allows us to be mindful.
Yes.
To remember that we have choices and we're the one choosing. You know, another way to talk about this mindfulness is like we write the stories of our lives and then become the character in the story. And we we call conversation with her friends, telling these stories often repeatedly, especially the ones that work well and they sound really good and you get a response. But then we become a victim of the story we've written, playing this often pathetic character, forgetting that, wait a minute, I'm the producer and the director of this whole production, and I can rewrite this story. It can have a it can have a happy ending.
It can. And, you know, people write their stories, and they write unhappy stories. Lots of people write unhappy stories for themselves. We call them pessimists, because it's safer for them to write an unhappy story, because, you see, for pessimists, unhappy stories do have one nice thing going for them. They all have happy endings. So they always end with that, I told you so, I knew it wouldn't work.
They get to be right a lot.
They get to be right almost all the time. So optimists are very courageous. Optimists are very courageous because quite often they won't get what they set out to accomplish. Quite often their goals are too big and they'll get most of the way there, but not all the way. It takes great courage to face disappointment and to go after things like that. But to honor yourself means to go for the most you can be, the best you can be, the greatest you can become. And to do that, to achieve all that's possible, what you have to do is you have to step out of what you know you can do into what you don't know you can do. You have to go into the improbable and even touch on what seemed to be impossible. To become the best you can be, you have to explore not only the known but the unknown, because you're capable of being, well, a lot greater than this.
You know, Steve, if you think about it, we really don't have any choice in this regard, because the only alternative would be to get our sense of love or self-respect from other people through some sort of performance. And we know this to be codependence. That's often the way it's described. I'm emotionally depending upon you to fill me up because I sort of feel like I could vote for myself, but I'm biased, so what difference does it make what I think about myself? And yet, that's where it begins, is with what you think
indeed
about yourself.
And, of course, if you put other people in the position of power of determining your happiness, then you don't have any choices. You know, like you're like a trained monkey trying to get, you know, applause. The idea is you have to please yourself. And you have to find out who that self is, and you have to go to paradise to find who that self is, and you have to do nice things for yourself. Now, the downside of doing nice things for yourself is that it's going to bring up your doubt and fear. The downside of doing any loving thing for yourself is that the parts of you that feel fear, that aren't feeling the love, are going to come up. Love brings up everything unlike itself. So it takes great courage to love yourself because it brings up the bad stuff. But when the bad stuff comes up, you get to release it. You get to acknowledge it, learn from it. You get to experience what it feels like.
Disagree with it.
Exactly. Exactly. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that your parents might have told you that just isn't true about you, but you're still holding on to it. Or school teachers. You had a school teacher once that told you you'd never be any good. You'd never be very creative. You know what I mean? You're
never any good at art.
Well, and yeah, so no matter what, there's a lot of messages from other people and from yourself. You know, messages you gave yourself about who you were when you were younger that you aren't anymore.
Part of my personal development, Steve, I was in my 40s when I finally did it, was to take an art class. I mean, a one-on-one, find a guy to teach me, and I did, how to draw. And I did it long enough to prove to myself that I could draw. And if I wanted to dedicate the time to it, I could be really, really good at it. But that was all I really needed to know. And then right. I let go of it. And it was sort of like to that junior high teacher, neater, 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 you know.
And what a great way to love yourself, to let go of those self-deprecating thoughts, those old ideas of yourself that you aren't good enough, that you aren't very good at this, that, or the other thing.
And that opens up the question of, well, how many other self-deprecating lies do I tell to myself? You know, how many other areas do I have untapped potential here in? And you know, Steve, a lot of this is just leftover programming from childhood, where it's reasonable that you earn self-respect by trying to please other people. That's what kids do, and self-love and self-trust. But as adults, think about it. How can I get self-love, self-trust, self-respect, self-confidence, self-esteem, self-assertiveness, self-aware from somebody else. I mean, self is in front of all of those.
How can you get any of those things without being self-centered? and you know, if you're not self-centered, where are you going to be? You know, where are you going to be centered? Somewhere else? The idea is self-centered does not mean selfish.
There you go.
Selfish is I take care of me, the heck with you. But self-centered is I take care of me so I can best take care
of
you.
That's the oxygen mask on the airplane.
There you go. If it drops down, put yours on first so you can take care of everybody else after you've made sure you're safe. So the first lesson in loving yourself is listen to those thoughts and feelings that are going on inside of you, and the negative ones that aren't true, release them. And you release negative thoughts and feelings by literally releasing your breath, releasing your muscle tension, releasing everything. And when the brain feels safe by doing that, the power, the fear that's involved in that thought dissipates.
Here's another nice tool. I use this with myself a lot when I find myself getting down on myself and being too critical. And that's to tell myself that I could treat myself with gentleness and kindness the way I would treat somebody else that I loved and cared about. Yeah. And it makes me look at why am I not doing that? You know, what is wrong in my life that somehow I am resisting the natural tendency to love myself? Or it's not just loving a person or loving an animal or loving what a beautiful flower this is or what a gorgeous day it is. But at some point it occurs to us, wait a minute, we're the lover here. We're the loved and the loving and the love.
All of the above. And so step one, love yourself by doing nice things for yourself. And one of those is to let go of those not nice thoughts that you have about yourself. But there's other ways to love yourself, too. You can love yourself by paying attention not to yourself, but rather take the attention off of yourself and put it on to someone you care about.
Number two, yeah, to look at enriching relationships. And to, I think this is great because here it's so clear that the benefit is in the giving.
Yes.
You know, like the show we did a week or two ago about give to give. You don't need anything in return if you're really in tune with and sensitive to the benefit you get right there in the moment,
yeah.
You know, the instant karma, if you will, of giving and letting go of it right there. No expectation.
So how do you love yourself more by being nice to somebody else?
Right.
I mean, basically, by listening to them more, closer, by paying better attention to them. You love yourself more by being a better friend, by being a better helper, by being a better colleague, by giving just a little bit more and taking a little bit less, as the Moody Blues said so eloquently so long ago.
Anytime we're in a situation that's awkward emotionally with friends or family and we want to be supportive, and you know, people will say to me, I just, in a situation like that, I just don't know what to say. And I remind them, as you just have said, Stephen, you don't have to say anything. You just have to maybe sometimes pay attention and be a good listener.
Yes.
And that's a gift to give to somebody, is to sit quietly and listen to them. And so everybody's got that.
Yeah. Maybe your greatest gift you can give someone is your attention.
Yeah.
Certainly, if you think about what does a baby want the most, you know, if it's not attention, you know, I mean, if it's not hurting, it wants attention. And I think that part doesn't leave us. We all want attention. And it's a wonderful gift. So the best way to love yourself more is to feel like you are being selfless, in a way, by you are caring about someone else. You are being interested. You are being compassionate to another human being.
And that it's what today in business they call the win-win situation. The more you give, the more you benefit.
Yeah.
So you prosper yourself by prospering others in all ways. Time, attention, caring, being patient, and tolerant even.
Yeah, enlightened self-interest.
Yeah, working to heal, working to understand. And again, if that feels like a sacrifice, often, you know, it's like, oh, gosh, you know, to be of service, it feels so daunting. Or couldn't I write a check or something, you know? And yet, it could be as simple as a little bit of time and attention. and you will benefit so directly. We all know this. Yeah. We're just reminding you.
I mean, one of the things I do every morning when I my wife wakes up is tell her that this is another day I get to treat her with respect and love and dignity and caring and compassion and tenderness. You know, I mean, it's like a moment and she hasn't had her coffee yet, so she's not even like coherent yet. And she gets to hear me say this wonderful, sweet thing to her, and she just sort of goes, oh. And you know, like, I think it's more for me than for her. You know, I mean, like, she loves it, and it makes her day start with this real safe, wonderful feeling. But it reminds me that I love myself. I love myself enough to be worthy of such a wonderful mate, that I love myself enough to remember what's important and to start my day with what's important. So do something nice for somebody that really is important to you. You know, I mean, the way to love yourself the most, I think, is of all the people out in the world, to pick the ones that you care about the most and do something nice for them.
That's a good place to begin, right? Charity begins at home, that kind of thing. Here's another idea, another way we can learn to love ourselves by giving to another person in relationship. And that's just going from needing to be right in an argument and needing that first to yielding and going to a more refined position of wanting to understand, giving up that whole need to be right thing and doing whatever you can to acknowledge your partner's feelings and their thoughts, their whole position, try to empathize and create some rapport, and substitute for that old-fashioned win-lose, need-to-be-right thing, some real genuine understanding. That's a nice gift.
Yeah, it really is. I mean, you love yourself more when the discussion you had with your spouse, for example, ends with you both understanding each other. That feels a lot better than you being right and they being wrong. I mean, even though you are right, it doesn't feel good in terms of the relationship when your spouse walks away from an argument feeling like the bad person or like they messed up, you know.
How could you win?
Yeah, Bill Cosby said, if you ever do win an argument with your wife, apologize immediately. You know, it's got to be seen as a team effort, you know, in terms of when you help someone you really, really care about and understand that just by giving to them, you love yourself more. The reason you're choosing them is because you love them. I mean, they're the ones you care about the most. So pick them. If you're thinking like, let me do something nice for somebody, who should I start with? Well, start with the ones that your heart is most drawn to. Start with the ones you love the most.
Yeah, be the one that initiates that.
Yeah.
You know, the grudge match where, well, I'll forgive him or her if they forgive me, I guess. Well, if they write me a letter, then I'll consider. Well, no, be the one that goes first.
Yeah.
Make that overture. Initiate.
What a great way to love yourself.
Forgiveness, yes.
By being the one who initiated.
I mean, if just from a logical place we consider how silly it is to say to ourselves, I'm going to punish this person that hurt me by carrying that hurt, waking it up every morning, carrying it around, dragging it around all day long, this hurt, this resentment, just turning it over and over in my mind to make sure it stays fresh. And that's how I'm going to seek vengeance and punish them. But wait a minute, I'm the one that's hurting.
They may have forgotten about me a long time ago.
What sense does that make? And I will never forget. And well, what if you did? What would we lose if we did, if we start forgiving? Forgiveness is part of this. Forgiveness is letting go, but I think the secret to that is understanding yourself. Understanding what you can understand about yourself from the hurt feeling allows you then to let it go, or you just jump down, turn around, and find out it's vaporized.
Yeah, and isn't it sort of obvious that the ones you love the most, the ones you care about the most, are the ones who are most likely to hurt you, you know, even inadvertently, you know, because you're so vulnerable to them. You're right. So sensitive to them because you're so open to who they are and, you know, letting them into your life. So
all your little vulnerable points, all your little...
So recognize that forgiveness...
Ticklish spots.
Yeah. I mean, although, you know, you have buttons and they push the buttons, but you walk around with shiny buttons sometimes. So understand that forgiving those people that you love the most, because they probably did things that made you upset, or they probably did things that you chose to respond or react to in negative ways. They probably did. I mean, you can't have a lifetime together with somebody without them doing things that rub you the wrong way occasionally. But one of the great ways you can love yourself is to forgive them. You know, that doesn't mean That doesn't mean, like, allow that same thing to happen again. It means let go of the you're angry inside of yourself at them, because they don't know about that. That's inside of you. Let go of the I'm angry at them inside of me. And forgiving them inside of me lets me love me more.
I think we can create, foster, and maintain a kind of a spiritual bond in marriage, if we want, that puts that commitment of this institution, as this marriage and family, ahead of everything. And just keep emphasizing, if we are committed, then everything else is going to work out. But what often happens, and the reason I think divorce rate is so high, and there's so much unhappiness, is that we have these false expectations of what a marriage should be.
Right.
And we're willing to sacrifice the marriage to, I don't know, maintain the income, or to keep the house, or to take that job promotion and move across the country. And, well, if you're not coming, goodbye. I mean, our priorities are all messed up. But if we put love above everything, then, oddly, everything else seems to take care of itself. Rather magically, wouldn't you say?
I totally agree, as long as we understand the kind of love we're talking about. And that's not lust after something, nor...
even romance, beyond even romance.
Yes. Real true love, like what the heart desires.
Harmony.
If you follow your heart.
Harmony, yeah. Feeling a connection to all things.
Yep.
Feeling in tune. And that sort of brings us to our third part, doesn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, it does, because another way to love yourself is to recognize that self is part of a much larger thing, and that's the ocean of humanity, the ocean of energy in the universe, and that by contributing to the nature of society, to humanity itself, you love yourself more as well.
Yeah, certainly culturally as well, anthropologically, but the urgency seems to be environmentally, and an awareness of an ecosystem that is singular, that's unified on a principle of diversity. Think about it. That's what the environment and the ecosystem, crudely the food chain, if you will, is based on, an idea that its strength and its unity requires diversity, and that these are not opposites. They're more like polarities. And that we can strive to work with this concept in a spiritual way and understand, maybe love your enemy, for example, or the nature of forgiveness in a whole new light if we, or as we, take a step back or sort of rise up to a slightly elevated point of view and see the bigger picture.
And that bigger picture happens as we find ourselves in paradise. And as we do, we recognize that higher self is part of this whole of all of people. And so we recognize...
Inalienable. They put it in the Declaration of Independence. Inalienable or unalienable cannot be separated from.
Right. And they give us these rights. You know, one of the a diverse thought popped into my head, but they say the pursuit of happiness in the Declaration of Independence, we have the right to pursue happiness. But what people don't understand is the word pursue in those days meant practice to mastery. You know, it doesn't mean like chase after. Pursue means like you've got something down and you're practicing and practicing and practicing until you become masterful at it. That's what Jefferson was saying. We have the right to become masterful at happiness, not we have the right to find it the elusive butterfly of love. You know, I mean, this is something we have the right to, and that is to practice and master happiness, not to see if we can find it somewhere. You don't have to do happy, you be happy.
Yeah.
So one of the things is to recognize we're part of this humanity thing, and that we're role models.
There's one life.
There's one energy, and we're an essential part of every other essential part of it. And so as we walk the world being happy, being a role model, being positive, we are making a difference in the world. I remember a story you told. You're walking out of class one day, and you stopped, and you just picked up a piece of trash, and you stuck it in your pocket. And one of your students said, well, you know, I thought about doing that, but, like, where would it stop? I'm going to do the block? Do I do the city? Do I do the neighborhood? And and your question was, it doesn't matter. The question is not where does it start. It's like, where does it start? And so if everybody did that, the point is you picked up a piece of paper, stuck it in your pocket, and you loved yourself more. You know, I mean,
yeah.
You did. Why wouldn't you? You did a good
thing. Well,
it was
easy because it was a little thing. That was the trick. It was a little thing, so I could take a little bit of credit for doing a little thing. And I felt better about it. You know, it's like that story in the original Chicken Soup for the Soul book. about the kid throwing the starfish back. And I said, that doesn't matter. And he said, well, it mattered to that one.
Yeah, sure made a difference for that one right there.
Yeah.
You know, so. And every green thing you do, you know, every good thing you do for the planet, you can love yourself more. I live off the grid. I live using solar power, you know, and I'm not wasting power like a lot of people are. I'm living as clean and green as I can, you know, and that feels good. I love myself more because I'm doing something nice for the planet.
The new language for that includes a small carbon footprint.
There you go.
Yeah,
there
you go. Generating a bunch of
I always believed in that when I went backpacking, you know, like take out what you put in. You know, don't leave your trash laying around.
Tread lightly.
Yeah, tread lightly. And so that's something you can do to contribute to the planet. You know, I mean, you know, all the things about saving gas and saving oil and not wasting your money on things that you know, are going to, like, deteriorate and not ever go back into the earth. You know, I mean, there's a lot of things. There's books and books and books of lists and lists and lists of things you could do. But the point is, yeah, the planet needs you to do this, but that's not what this podcast is about. This is ways to love yourself. Doing something nice for the planet is nice for the planet, but it's also really nice for yourself.
Yeah. And if you're still having a problem with this concept because you're sort of stuck in the idea of love only in a romantic or lustful way, consider that we're talking about self-respect. What if you called it self-respect? Would it be easier for you to foster self-respect and self-love, and then consider how close they are? They're certainly first cousins.
Absolutely. Self-approval, you know. I mean, whatever you want to call it, the idea of your opinion of you matters a lot.
Yeah.
And your opinion of you is going to be significantly affected when you do nice things for you, when you do nice things for others, and when you do the nice things for the planet. Your opinion of you will rise. Whatever you want to call that, call it love, call it appreciation, call it respect. And as your love for you increases, as we said, all love flows through your own love for you. The ramifications are nothing more or less than a miracle, I think. I mean, this is what the miracle of life is all about. The more you love yourself, the more love you have to share with others, and the more love others have that you'll allow yourself to feel. So all the love, what you give, what you receive, is all regulated by this one thing. All love flows through your own love for you. But remember, it flows through you. It doesn't get stuck there. It flows through. That means you love yourself, and that flows through so you can love others so they can love you, so you can love others so they can love you. It flows. It's a cycle thing.
That's where the whole idea of unconditional comes from. Unconditional love, but also unconditional all of your feelings so you can get back to the love through understanding as soon as possible. You know, the visual that came up for me just now as you were describing this, these three levels or layers, is a little pebble or a drop of water in a pool that then ripples out and radiates out, and that in the middle is love yourself by treating yourself as if you're somebody you really love.
Yeah, be nice to you like you are to the people you really love.
Yeah, and find that better, more refined, the spiritual nature, those more refined values, that's the word I'm looking for. And then that sort of radiates out from the center into relationships, you know, our primary relationships with our family and our friends and the people that we work with and our community in a larger sense. Responsibility to the community and to the state and the nation, and then we move into the bigger circle, which is the world and the environment and the impact of the way we eat, not only on our body but on the world, and the efficiency of the cars, the carbon footprint. And the greatest idea as we move out ultimately is that we're just dealing with one thing. It goes from more complex and diverse toward harmony, or through harmony, to this eventual unity. Each step of the way, learning to love yourself more completely.
And that's really the start. You know, love yourself so that you can love others, so that you can love the planet, so that as you love others and it comes back to you, you love yourself enough to let that come in, and so that you love the planet, and so that the beauty of the planet, the wonders of the planet, you'll let in.
That's...
Again, if you only love yourself a little bit, then you won't let yourself appreciate the beauty around you. To whatever extent you love yourself, that's how much love you're going to let in, from the planet, from an individual, from yourself. So expanding your love for yourself. Do this for self-centered reasons. Do it so that you can become more centered in yourself. Do nice things for you. Do nice things for people you care most about. Do nice things for the planet so that you love yourself more, so that you become a better role model, so that the planet becomes a better place.
Before we do our audio journey and install this whole three-level concept here of how to love yourself in these three wonderful new ways, a new paradigm or model for you perhaps, I want to talk just briefly, Steve, about political activism, social activism, any kind of sense of reform or change that comes from frustration or, even worse, anger. And the idea that politics and the hostility and the anger and the animosity that we often find in that arena is the best way to view the need for improvement in the world, and maybe a better way to look at the need for peace and justice in the world is from a less angry place and a more loving place, starting again with yourself in the center, where the drop impacts the pool and begins to radiate out. And instead of needing the world to change so that we benefit, be the change we wish to see in the world so that the world benefits, and radiate that out into the world, not from an angry place, but from a kind and gentle and loving place with vision and hope and harmony.
That's the key. And when the self is experiencing anger, the self's never angry. But when the self is experiencing anger, then what it can do is experience the anger and get beneath the anger to the hurt and or the fear, and express the hurt and the fear in a safe and loving way.
We got to do that again. Well, it's been quite a while, and it's so fundamental to go back to that. The way that anger and hatred sit on top of hurt, personal hurt, very subjective,
yep.
And that all of that sits on fear. And
on top of fear. And all that fear is all about the unknown.
Yeah, let's do an anger management show.
But being nice to yourself, one of the things that you can do to be nice to yourself is to manage your anger, you know, and to find a way to get past expressing angrily and go to the hurt and express kindly and gently the hurt or the fear that's going on.
That's like, remember Don Knotts used to say to Andy, we're going to nip it. We're going to nip it in the bud.
Yeah,
we can do that emotionally. We can get to the point where you can see your anger coming a mile away and go, you know, if I keep doing what I'm doing and don't create some change here, I think I'm going to be pretty angry in a few minutes. I mean,
yeah.
And then you can make some better decisions to nip it in the bud, to head it off at the pass.
It's all that big picture perspective. You're standing in front of the train and the cars are going by. You see a car going by, but if you can stand up on that mountain, you can see it's going to crash up there. You know, you can see the tracks are out, you know, the bridge is out. So
from that elevated point of view.
That's right. So one of the nicest things you can do for yourself is to extricate yourself from those effective expressions of anger at yourself, at the people you love the most, to find yourself knowing that deeper than the anger is the hurt, and let's get down to the hurt and let's express the hurt. And that way the people that you express it to grow closer to you, because when you inappropriately express anger at people, they get frightened and they move away from you.
That's right. And one final thought as we move to the audio journey: the game is rigged. When you explore yourself, you will always come up with treasure. It might surprise you the areas where the treasures are. Often you will say to yourself, you know, I sort of had a feeling that I had a talent or a gift or some hidden undeveloped ability in that area far out. But everybody has gifts, as Steve likes to say.
although some people never open their packages, yeah. We all do have the gifts.
There's packages under the Christmas tree that we haven't even seen yet. We have not only have we not opened the package, we don't even know they're there.
One of our favorite expressions is, you'll find the best of yourself in places you never even knew to look.
Yep. See, if you love yourself, if you trust yourself, if you respect yourself, if you believe in yourself, you're willing to risk, that's self-love. Those are all qualities or components of what we're talking about. And then you take that to yourself, to your relationships, to the world around you in the most inclusive and harmonious way.
And so to love yourself more in three separate ways all involve being nice to yourself, to someone you care about, and to the world. And let's do an audio journey about being nice.
It's a nice word. Nice.
It is, isn't it nice?
Nice word.
I remember Tina Turner said, we don't do nothing nice. We're going to do this nice. And
although she's a meditator.
Yes,
actually.
Indeed. So take a deep breath and... It always feels nice to go to paradise. Eyes closed, release, find that place of perfect peace.
To feel safe is to create and sense in your body a feeling of letting go of muscular tension, of releasing pressure, muscles unwinding, letting go, relaxing, and feeling really, really safe.
And that's one way to feel nice about yourself, is to let yourself feel safe. Whenever you find yourself here in paradise, whenever you feel safe enough to close your eyes and let your breathing be deep and gentle and rhythmic, allow your muscle tension to release and your anxiety to cease and your confusion to abate, and you let yourself feel great. Anytime you find yourself here in paradise, you're doing something nice for yourself. And here in paradise, you can do lots of nice things, including rehearse what you're going to do when you're awake. So take a moment now and just plant a seed in your mind, a seed that is destined to take, that when you find yourself doing something really good, that you stop and you pat yourself on the back. And you notice the things that you have, and you seem to overlook your lack. Be nice to yourself. Say sweet things. Treat yourself with tender kindness and gentleness, too. Be nice to yourself. Be nice to who you are, and be nice to yourself about what you do.
Learn to forgive yourself, to substitute understanding for a need to be right, to substitute understanding for a fear that you've lost an argument or you were shamed or humiliated in a situation and you'll never live it down because everyone, of course, will remember it forevermore and be thinking about it every time they see you and,
release.
It's a fantasy.
Release.
Let it go. The brain's trying to protect you, and it's going to come up with all kinds of cockamamie schemes while you may be carrying this muscular tension, but right now you go even deeper and more relaxed and feel another level of muscular tension just fall away. Loving yourself in this way. Letting go, forgiving, letting go of muscular tension, loving yourself, understanding.
And be nice to yourself by loving your thoughts, the ones that you get to release, the ones that you empower and bring you peace. And be nice to yourself by finding those that you care about most and finding a way to love them, to be special to them, to listen more than talk, to assist more than ask, to give just a little bit more and take a little bit less to someone special. Love yourself by allowing the love you feel for someone else to be expressed in a gentle, tender, wondrous, and giving way.
feel yourself offering up love, kindness, understanding, patience, even tolerance, without condition. Offering it up, letting it go, radiating without condition to create room for more. And you can feel as you give, without any need to receive, the immediate fulfillment. As you give more, you receive more, and thus enhance the flow and love yourself more by loving other people.
And when it comes to who to express that love to, ask your heart. Ask your heart who matters the most, who do I care about the most, who's the most important to me, and love them first. Love you, then love them, and take it to yet another level and love humanity as a whole. Do something nice for the planet herself. Do something that makes you feel like you've contributed even just a tiny little bit, because the difference between nothing and a tiny little bit is enormous.
There is but one life at work here, and in spite of the appearance of separation on various levels, there is a harmony where all diversity is connected in ways that often are difficult to recognize, but know nevertheless. From the most holistic point of view, that we live in a universe, but one thing at work. Your point of view is unique. Your talents and gifts are diverse. An important part of the strength and the vitality of the one thing developed from the essence of uniqueness. And love yourself by loving all that is, you and everything, and every seemingly separated thing in you.
So love yourself in three ways. Love yourself by doing something nice for yourself. Love yourself by doing nice for someone that you care about. And love yourself by doing something nice for humanity, something nice for the planet. Love yourself in these three ways. When you're especially feeling low, when you're feeling blue, when you're feeling down and you don't know what to do, well, do one of these things. Love yourself. Do something nice for you or for someone else or for the planet as a whole. Do something nice and it'll heal your soul. When you don't know what to do and you're feeling blue, do something nice. It feels good inside of you. And when you're feeling great, when you're feeling like on a roll and you're feeling like wonderful and you're feeling whole, well, then especially remember to do something nice for you and something nice for other people and the planet too. When you're feeling great, that's the time when you can create doing something even nicer yet. So whether you're feeling down or whether you're feeling up, being nice is your safest bet.
I love it when you get on a roll like that.
Thank you.
I can feel it rolling through the room. And you know, it'll be easy to remember how this feels. You can bring it to mind and recreate it with a single slow, deep breath and an intention to be gentle and kind to yourself. It all begins with loving yourself. If not you, who? If not now, when? And it's not even a matter so much of giving and receiving love as if it were a commodity, as being the love you wish to see in the world. Be that love, feelings that you can bring with you effortlessly as you reorient toward the sound of our voices. Remember the room in which you sit.
Take a deep breath. And as it feels comfortable to you, take another deep breath and bring yourself back to wide awake. Feeling, kind of nice. And remember, nice is a state of mind. Nice is paradise thinking. And we recommend this paradise thinking every day of your life. Do something nice for you. Do something nice for everyone else, too. And you'll love yourself more. Remember, all love flows through your own love for you.
And when you find yourself, your true self, the real higher self, in paradise, where else would you find them but in paradise? You'll have a best friend for life. It's just that simple.
Yeah, yourself. That is your best friend for life.
Right.
We promise the self you'll find is one you're going to really, really love. There's no, like, bad selves down there. People who do bad things, it's because they don't know themselves. And people who know who they really are, well, we're all beings that emanate light. We're all a star.
Here's a way to love yourself more. Wage inner peace. Take a friend to FocusPassion.com. Okay? FocusedPassion.com, remember the ED, and that's FocusedPassion.com, and get them signed up just like you did for only 99 cents a week. Now, it's perfectly okay with us if you copy these programs, burn them to CDs or DVDs, put them on thumb drives, but come on, for 99 cents a week, it's just easier to get your friends signed up, and they'll get the auto-download, the podcast, right into their computer. So go there now, and as always, be gentle, love life, and take care of each other. For Steve Snyder, this is Michael Benner.
The thought that life could be better is woven.